There's a lot of BS from influencers and shady supplement companies that give you false promises about ways to boost your metabolism. The truth is, things like pills and drinks will never do anything for your metabolism. But there are 5 things science shows you can do to increase your metabolism, and I'm gonna break those down for you right now. So before I get into the first thing, there's 2 considerations we need to make first. One is, let's define metabolism. So for the purpose of this video, we're just gonna call it your resting metabolic rate. So we're not talking about things you can do like going for walks to help burn more calories. While that's fantastic, it's one of the best things you can do to lose fat, it's not the same thing as actually increasing your resting metabolic rate. The second thing is, of course, genetics matter. In fact, there was a research paper that looked at over 6,000 people, and even when people weighed the same weight, there were some people who burned a lot of calories through their resting metabolic rate, and there were several people who burn very few. Now, of course, there's nothing you can do about your genetics, so don't let it get you down. And there's actually good news too. Research has shown just having a faster or slower metabolism doesn't predict weight gain, and the main difference comes from food and activity habits to counteract those variations. But of course, the faster your metabolism is, the better off you're gonna be, and if for no other reason, you'll be able to enjoy more food. So what can you do to speed up your metabolism? Well, the first thing is making sure you regularly exercise, and that's both either cardio or strength training. And that might sound a little confusing. I just talked about how we're not talking about things where you intentionally burn calories through activity. And especially when it comes to cardio, I'm actually usually pretty hard on that. I say don't over rely on it, because research shows the more you do cardio, the more your body adapts to it, you end up burning less calories through the same amount of activity, and you just have to keep doing more and more. But that's just talking about the calories burned during the activity itself and not the impacts to your resting metabolic rate. And there's actually 2 papers I want to refer to, one on men and one on women, that looked at differences in resting metabolic rate between those who were sedentary, those who were aerobically trained, and those who were resistance trained. And in the paper on females, those who regularly exercised, whether it was aerobically or resistance trained, both saw about a 7% higher resting metabolic rate than those who were sedentary. In the male study, they saw the same results for aerobically trained people. It was still about 7% higher, but those who were resistance trained actually saw a whopping 15% higher resting metabolic rate than those who were sedentary. So it just goes to show that exercising as a habit does improve your resting metabolic rate. But one of the questions is, why was there such a big difference in the resistance training between females and males? And the only thing I can do is speculate, and I think it's probably because men have much higher levels of testosterone. They're able to build muscle easier, they're able to build much more muscle, and we know that having more muscle does increase your resting metabolic rate. Which brings me right to the second thing you do: build more muscle. Now, it's commonly believed a pound of fat burns about 2 calories per day, whereas a pound of muscle burns about 6 calories per day. However, there's also some research that shows you might be able to burn as much as an additional 15 calories for every pound of muscle. So you can look at it and say probably somewhere between about 6 and 15 for every pound. And is that a huge amount? No, but it does add up over time and it can help. Plus, you also have to factor in not just the muscle built, but all the things that you need to do to build muscle are also metabolically demanding. So if you want to build muscle, need to be resistance training. Resistance training not only burns calories during the exercise, but there's also something called EPOC, which stands for excess post-exercise oxygen consumption, where you can burn additional calories above your normal baseline for up to 48 hours post-training. You don't get this with cardio. In fact, there was a study that showed after running a mile, it comes back to baseline within just 15 minutes. Not only that, if you want to build muscle, you have to eat more protein. Protein has an extremely high thermic effect of food. There's even research that showed eating more calories by increasing your protein showed greater fat loss than eating less calories and less protein. And you also have to take into consideration metabolism with age. Research has shown you do lose about 1-2% off your metabolism every decade once you get into about your 30s. However, when you equate for lean body mass, you actually don't see any slowdowns in metabolism all the way up until the age of 60. So when you take all those things into consideration, far and away the best thing you can do to help your metabolism is focus on building muscle. The third thing you do, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this because everyone always glosses over it. However, sleep is important. It's one of the most underrated parts of not only metabolism, but a healthy lifestyle. Several studies have shown sleep improves your resting metabolic rate, rates of muscle protein synthesis, muscle retention in a fat loss phase. Not to mention, when you're well rested, you typically have a better attitude. You're more likely to stay on plan. So don't skimp out on sleep. Now, the fourth thing you can do is reverse diet. Now, this one's controversial, and I'm someone who talks about reverse dieting all the time. I have well over 100 videos on the topic on my channel. However, it's kind of misunderstood what reverse dieting does for your metabolism. Yes, it can help improve your metabolism, but what it does is it helps undo the suppression in your metabolism if you're finishing a diet, or especially if you have a long history of extreme dieting, crash dieting, yo-yo dieting, and you've run your metabolism into the ground because of it. Reverse dieting is going to help improve your metabolism, but it's to get it to where it's supposed to be based on your genetic potential and not about increasing it past that genetic potential. Plus, look at it this way. If you eat more calories, your metabolism will speed up. But of course, you don't want to just gain a bunch of body fat. But if you don't know, reverse dieting is where you gradually increase your calories. And what this does is helps your metabolism speed up, but your body can keep up and it helps minimize fat gain during the process. Whereas if you just shot your calories right up really fast, you're going to gain a bunch of body fat, not something you probably want to do. So especially if you have an extreme history of dieting and you feel like your metabolism is tanked, that's probably the only way you're going to get out of this rut and set yourself up for success. But if you don't know how to do this or anything about it, I'll put a video in the description you can check out after this one's done. The fifth thing you can do, and this one's not so much about increasing your metabolism, but more about keeping your metabolism from slowing down more than it should whenever you're in a fat loss phase. Because when you are losing weight, your metabolism will slow down. There's no way around this, but you can help minimize those slowdowns. And this is going to help you make sure you get all the way where you want to be. Because what a lot of people do is they get really aggressive right up front and try to lose weight as fast as possible. I know it's what everyone wants and it's super exciting, but what it does is it just destroys your metabolism, gets you stuck, and you're nowhere near your goal. So you want to make sure when you're in a fat loss phase, you're not losing more than about 1% of your weight on average per week. I usually say anywhere between about 0.5 to 1% is usually a pretty good pace, because losing much more than about 1% is going to put you at much greater risk of losing muscle. We already talked about what that does for your metabolism, and just seeing bigger metabolic slowdowns and hormonal changes. So you don't want to go too fast. You also want to break up your dieting. So what you're gonna do is take something called diet breaks along the way, where you go back to maintenance every handful of weeks. What this does is keep your body from guarding against fat loss so much. And there's different ways you can handle this, and it kind of depends. But I also have a video you can check out right here next that talks about what diet breaks are, how to implement them, and pretty much everything you need to know. So make sure you check that out next, and I'll see you in that other video.